From a passenger perspective, the term transatlantic might have you debating internally on whether you would prefer to book a flight with a North American carrier or a European carrier. If heading towards Europe, you might also be looking at flight times and which service might provide the best sleep. But when it comes to pilots, traversing this part of the world offers its own intriguing experiences. Indeed, the North Atlantic is one of the most unique airspaces in the world. The NATS, or North Atlantic tracks, are traversed hundreds of times daily in both directions, and the North Atlantic is one of the busiest oceanic airspaces. There are many discussion-worthy topics related to the North Atlantic crossings, and this video will focus on the track system and how pilots communicate with ATC while in oceanic airspace. So, if you're ready, let's get started. Before we get into things, two small notes. As mentioned in the introduction, the routes that pilots follow across the North Atlantic are called the North Atlantic tracks. We apologize in advance for using the word tracks over and over again, but it is truly the main topic of the video. Additionally, a North Atlantic track can be called NAT for short, or NATS if it's plural. We recognize that this sounds identical to the UK organization NATS, which is a major provider of air traffic control services. Indeed, NATS, the air traffic control service, in overseeing its Shanwick facility, is involved in controlling access to the NATS, the North Atlantic tracks. But moving on, these tracks are generated daily by air traffic control centers in charge of the airspace and are published ahead of the respective eastbound or westbound rush for that day. The image shown here is the second daily track update from April 19, 2024. The westbound tracks are purple and the eastbound ones are amber. The letters correspond to each of the tracks. In this example, however, we can see that tracks A and Y and B and Z share significant route segments. The tracks are constructed by linearly linking multiple latitude and longitude GPS coordinates across the oceanic airspace. The NATS are designed to take advantage of the most favorable tailwinds eastbound and avoid the worst westbound headwinds. For this reason, the westbound tracks tend to be north of the eastbound tracks. The headwind is less severe towards the polar latitudes. The route names are simply monikered with letters. Pilots ensure that the track they're assigned to fly matches the track letter they use to load the flight plan. In addition to this, the named tracks are numbered according to the Julian day of the year. For example, the tracks published for February 20th would have 51 assigned to them, since it's the 51st day of the calendar year. This number is significant since the local date differs by 4 to 5 hours every day on both ends of the tracks. When it comes to entering Flight Information Region or FIR boundaries, here's how the process works. Tracks are published and primarily controlled by Gander and Shanwick centers. Reykjavik, Shannon, Santa Maria, and other locales also have control centers, but the North Atlantic tracks are primarily controlled by the two primary centers. Gander is located in Newfoundland and Labrador, Canada, while Shanwick is in Scotland in the United Kingdom. Before entering the track system, every flight that traverses the oceanic tracks needs to establish contact with Gander, flying eastbound, or Shanwick, flying westbound. This is done to receive an assigned altitude and airspeed for the crossing. This initial contact can be made up to 90 minutes before entering the oceanic airspace. Early contact is helpful because it enables pilots to calculate performance variables, such as if they need to burn more fuel to fly at the altitude assigned by the center. A North Atlantic mission, either eastbound or westbound, requires no fewer than 3 air traffic control or ATC clearances. Not to be confused with the flight plan on file from the dispatcher, clearances are given by ATC to the edge of their jurisdiction. When a flight departs from the US to Europe, the pilots receive a clearance from their departure airport to their oceanic entry point. Secondly, pilots receive a clearance from the Gander Center before entering the tracks, known as their oceanic clearance. Lastly, Shanwick Center will issue a clearance off the tracks and into European airspace. This string of three clearances is required on every flight and is unique compared to simple continental flying.
From March 2024, the NAT region will no longer require the flight crews to be in receipt of an oceanic clearance prior to crossing the oceanic entry point. Removal of the oceanic clearance has been enabled through the implementation of significant advancements in communications, navigation, and surveillance technology that have improved safety and service.
Flying at the assigned altitude and speeds while on the tracks is essential. Pilots maintain HF or high-frequency radio communications while in oceanic airspace, but the nature of HF limitations slows communication. Because of this, most planes and pilots use CPDLC, or controller/pilot data link communications, as the primary means for sending messages back and forth. CPDLC allows text messages to be sent back and forth and is much quieter than continuously monitoring scratchy, high-pitched HF radios. CPDLC is used for strategic messages, such as adjusting airspeed or altitude. Additionally, pilots can transmit using their VHF radios on frequency 123.45 to notify planes around them during emergencies. This quickly alerts other pilots of a possible emergency descent and allows pilots closer to land to relay the distress call to the ground faster than HF or CPDLC messages could be composed. Moving on, there are many daily flights that fly across the North Atlantic and other bodies of water without utilizing the established track routes. Known as random routing, these flight plans are put together by dispatchers and approved by the respective control centers for a few reasons. One of the primary uses of random routing is to cross the Atlantic at a lower or higher altitude than the published tracks. The tracks use altitudes from 34,000 to 39,000 feet. However, there are times that planes are too heavy to climb initially to 34,000. As a result, they will be filed on a random route at lower altitudes. This random route might follow the tracks, but would not be eligible for a track clearance since the pilots could not comply with the altitude. And then there's Slop. Another interesting point about oceanic flying is offset procedures. Commonly called slopping, SLOP or S-L-O-P stands for a strategic lateral offset position that is allowed in oceanic airspace. Pilots can offset up to 2 miles to the right of their assigned track, whether flying from Honolulu to Los Angeles or New York to Paris. This is done to avoid the wake turbulence of planes flying in front. Since every plane on a common track follows the same lateral course and generally the same speed, a flight could be a few miles in track of another aircraft for an entire crossing. The ability to offset allows pilots to get out from behind another plane's wake turbulence, allowing them to turn the seatbelt sign off and the flight attendants to conduct service. Thus, even though passengers may be completely unaware of the term, they'll be highly appreciative when their pilots engage in slopping. So, if you've ever flown across the North Atlantic, you've also probably been involved in the track system. The tracks require daily coordination between meteorologists, controllers, dispatchers, and pilots. It's the track system that allows the North Atlantic to be the busiest oceanic airspace. Without this order and consistency made possible by the tracks, hundreds of daily flights between Europe and North America would not be possible. And so, did you know about the tracks of the North Atlantic? Share your experience with us by leaving a comment down below. Simple Flying publishes over 150 articles every week. If you're looking for the latest aviation news and insights, visit simpleflying.com.